Jonas, start with DeepSeek, because I've heard from some in this room that it's a Sputnik moment, echoing what we heard from, of course, Andreessen Horowitz, and others saying it's a flash in the pan. Where do you stand on DeepSeek?
Well, first of all, it's basically a continuation of what we've been seeing for years. These models get better, they get more efficient, open source is developing. So it's basically a confirmation of what we've been positioning ourselves for years. So for us, it's a victory lap. For our customers, it's a victory lap.
A more incremental than Sputnik moment.
Well, yes, but I mean, of course, it's a Sputnik moment also because China is maybe in some regions ahead of the US for the very first time. So that's certainly that.
You're offering it to your clients now.
Yeah.
Have you tested it? Are you data secure on this? What has the response been?
Yeah, I mean, our strategy is to include open source models, right? So we've been doing this with Llama, we've been doing this with other great models, and we've been doing this with DeepSeek. And so our customers are large enterprises and governments. So any transformation you're doing for these customers takes years and years. So what is today the very best model is almost irrelevant. They just need a partner that can guarantee that they can leverage the best of open source together with innovation they need for their own business.
You've told me in the past you think large language models will end up being commoditized and essentially price will drop to zero. And yet, on the stage behind us, Macron, the president of France, is going to get up and announce 109 billion euros of investment to kind of match Stargate in the US. Is that funding misspent, both in the US and Europe? Is this misaligned?
So we need funding. We need funding for our companies, we need funding for infrastructure, but what I worry is that we are getting distracted and putting too much focus on infrastructure. Infrastructure is not gonna save us. Infrastructure investment alone will not solve digital sovereignty. What we need is value creation, we need innovation, and then the infrastructure comes almost automatically as a second order effect.
You pivoted from building out large language models to building out generalized AI operating systems. Very much focused on the enterprise. I know you're going to push back on the word pivot here.
Yeah.
What has the response been? As you reflect back on that, was that the right decision? How are your investors feeling about that?
So DeepSeek, for our investors, they were having a party, right? Because this is precisely what we've been positioning ourselves for. We can solve the general purpose task, like writing a poem for your mother's birthday or like email replies. Our customers can solve that with the best of open source models. But one thing all our customers have in common is that the things that are really valuable, they care about, like compliance workflows, government workflows, manufacturing, requirements engineering, all these open source models can't do it. So we are adding our own innovation to solve that, and everybody's winning.
What's that doing for revenues at Aleph Alpha? What do they come in at in 2024? And what's your target for this year?
So I'm not going to tell you my target, but I'm going to tell you that we just recently signed a 19 million contract with the German labor agency, work agency, employment agency. So these are the kind of contracts we're currently signing. And I think that is numbers worth getting out of the bed for.
You're a German startup. Elon Musk is meddling, some would say, in German politics. What lessons do you take from that? Elon Musk supporting the AfD in Germany, a right-wing party.
I mean, to be fair, we've been meddling in US elections as well, right? So it's like some German politicians have been very vocal about their preference.
Nothing
for,
like this. Come on, Jonas.
Does it
underscore your desire to have sovereign AI? You have a tech mogul interfering in German politics.
So I don't like it, right? But I think there's nothing really we can do about it right now. The US are still our partners, are still our friends, and we need to find a solution together with the democratic countries, together with our partners.
OpenAI were talking to me earlier, and they said the two leaders in AI are the US and the CCP, the Communist Party of China. Do you agree? Does Europe have skin in the game here, really?
So that's probably correct, but this is not a zero-sum game. This is not about who's the first and everyone else is empty-handed, right? We, at Davos, just 2 weeks ago, we're the first team that launched an evolution of the transformer architecture. And I talked to several research labs, leading research labs, US researchers, that are now starting to look at that. So it's, with all likelihood, the next architecture, the next evolution of the transformer is coming out of Europe.
Do we need to be worried that we can't access or we can't build out our own semiconductors? Not only do you have NVIDIA and AMD in the US, but you also have Amazon and Microsoft developing their own semiconductors around artificial intelligence. Is that a gap that we need to close, and how do we do it?
Well, that's a painful gap, certainly, right? Also the fact when you look at the CapEx the hyperscalers have assembled, that's almost impossible to kind of reach the same levels. And it's equally unlikely that we'll build a competitor to AMD or NVIDIA, basically, with a snip of a finger. So that's painful, but it's a reality we have to accept. And I think every money that is directed against, like, building a competitor to these juggernauts is wasted money.